This is an interview with Mrs. Eva Boros on February 11, 1983 in Southfield, Michigan. The interviewer is Kay Roth.
Do you have no cold here?
Right. No, it's fine. I don't know. I keep my house cold, so whatever you're comfortable. Oh, I have lots of tapes, too, so if we go more than one tape, I have 3 hours of the tape. We'll start by asking you some questions about your background before the war. Where were you born in the day?
I was born in Bratislava, which is Czechoslovakia. And this is the Slovak part of Czechoslovakia. And my mother comes from Burgenland, which is Austria, the Hungarian part of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy. And my father is from Slovakia, which is heart of Slovakia. I come from an Orthodox, very religious house, and was brought up in a very, very strict religious kosher and so on mm-hmm. upbringing. My father was a member of the Hapoel Mizrahi ever since I remember, and was in a Zionistic group. All of us, we were four children, I was the youngest, were in Zionistic groups, which was the Bnei Akiva, actually the Mizrahi is the father and the son group, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
They are more or less even and similar. I would say it was a more modern Orthodox way of upbringing. I went to an all-girls school, also the same Orthodox from the Jewish community in the town. Bratislava was a very important place for the Jewish, European Jewish community, because it has a very famous rabbinical school. And one of the very, very, it doesn't matter. Anyway, my brother took part, he went to the rabbinical school ever since his childhood, the one that my surviving brother.
Who's in Israel now?
Pardon?
Even Israel?
Yeah, the one that is surviving. And we had a big family in Bratislava. Eckstein was a pretty well-known family because it had so many parts and many. We did not have a, my mother's side was Austrian, so she actually was implanted into this society, so I had mostly my father's side.
It was Eckstein you said was your name?
Eckstein, E-C-K-S-T-E-I.
Mm-hmm.
And there were several rabbis, well-known rabbis there, and the one that I wanted to say was the Chatam Sofer. Chatam Sofer, he was the famous rabbi that had, I don't know why he was so famous, but he was very famous, and he made that big rabbinical school and so on. So anyway, in 1940, my father owned a pretty big store with, how do you call it, porcelain and ceramics and
China,
kitchen utensils, China and all that. And more or less this was the trait of the whole family. They all had the same kind of store.
I mean there was more than one store?
Yeah, more than one Eckstein
uh-huh.
for the same thing
uh-huh.
in the town.
Uh-huh.
So, in 40, of course in 39 I think Hitler entered Czechoslovakia, if I'm not mistaken. And in 40, they gave permission to whoever was in the Nazi party of the Slovak Nazi party to take possession of whatever Jewish possession there are, and they just could come in and tell the store owner that from tomorrow on you don't have to even come anymore. And it was then just given, you know, you just were put out of your store, and that was the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
And what you did or what you didn't, it was your business. So in 42, the first Jewish young people were sent to concentration camps, and the whole Czechoslovakia, since Bratislava is on the border of Austria, was sent through the Bratislava. And so my father, since the store wasn't owned anymore, he started to work with the Jewish community center, I would call it, of the town, which organized itself more or less into what they could still have, and started to take food to the people that went through the town, and my father was one of those. There is a book, actually, that does mention the family and my father himself in a book that came out in Israel by a gentleman named Dr. Neumann. I have the book if you are interested, but it's written in German. So, the spoken language in Bratislava was German.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And we at home spoke German.
No Yiddish?
Not Yiddish, no.
How old were you?
I was born in 32, so 39 I was, how old was I? 7 years old, and then, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The end of 32, I was November, which I mean...
mm-hmm.
So, at this point in 42, my father decided that we have family in Hungary. And he sent my sister, who is older about 5 or 6 years from me. She was born in 27, and my brother, my oldest brother, who died in concentration camp in Austria, he was born in 25. So they sent them to Hungary to relatives.
This is Hungary proper then?
Yeah, in Budapest. Mm-hmm. Hungary, Budapest.
Mm-hmm.
Now, since the border were closed and it was absolutely impossible to cross a border at any other way but with a passport, with a legal passport. Being a Jew, if you would have done it, you would have just been taken straight to the concentration camp. So there was a pretty, it wasn't only my father, so there were many people that did it, and they just crossed the border illegally. There were people that were willing to take them across for money. Slovak peasants that lived on the border, and so that's how it was done. There was a maid, and has been made from that my mother kept in touch, and she organized this for us. So my sister was taken first, then my brother was taken, and they lived in Budapest with those relatives. Since 42, we stayed in Czechoslovakia because of my father's job. They gave us an extra addition, or what you call it?
Ration?
Pardon?
Ration?
No. Ration, there were long rations, but that we did not, because since 42, not only young people were taken to concentration camps, but most of the whole community. In fact, most of the Jewish community. I cannot tell you the number, how many 100,000 lived in Bratislava, but it was a huge community. And I think that at least 80% of this was gone by 44. So in, and of course, in 42 we started to hear the first how do you call them? People started to bring news about what is really going on.
Rumors.
The rumors. It was more than rumors. There were facts. What goes on with the Polish Jews. Meanwhile, Polish Jews started also to sift through the borders to Czechoslovakia. They found that this is to Hungary and to Czechoslovakia. Since Hungary was not yet taken by Hitler, they were still independent, but they declared that they are willing to be in the war with Hitler, which means that they did not have to be policed by the Hitler, actually the Nazi regime, so they were independent, and that's why the Jews had more rights still there until 1944. So in that was all this time, most of our relatives were gone from Bratislava, including all, and all those that didn't live in Bratislava too. Then Czechoslovakia decided in 42 or 43 to have also forced labor camps inside Czechoslovakia, where they sent most of those Jews that they found still for use to work. And there were camps for families. So part of my family, of family members were there, but not my immediate family. So in 44 February, the rumors started to come that things are not so good for the I mean, I think in 44, the beginning of 44, Hitler had to start returning, how do you say,
retreat.
And I think at this point they started to be real vicious. Vicious, I mean, how more vicious could it be? But they just wanted to clear out everything. Including, of course, what they needed most was the money and the gold that these Jews still owned somehow.
Mm-hmm.
In 44 February, my father decided to send me and my brother to Hungary, across the border of Hungary, because he felt that it's very unsafe to stay there.
To Budapest?
To Budapest too, to the same relatives who were not willing to accept us anymore because they were afraid of their own life. Things there started to stink too. So both of us were put into a camp which was guarded by the Hungarian Nazi Party.
With just Jewish families or children or?
Everybody. Children, families, whatever. Everybody that didn't have a legal right to be a Hungarian. So we were there about 6 weeks. In March 14, the Germans entered Hungary. My brother was put into a legal Hungarian Jewish orphanage, and I was put in the legal Jewish orphanage for girls at this point. Now, when the day the Germans entered, the next day the Jewish girls' orphanage had to be emptied out because the building was a huge building and they needed the building. So at this point I decided to run away from there. My two brothers, with the three of us, decided to go on our own back to Bratislava because there was no point in staying there. It was the same in there as here. My sister, the four of us wanted to do that, but my sister was not allowed by the relatives, our relatives, to leave because they gave some assurances to the government that they take care of her. So in order of saving their own skin, they did not let her go. Okay? So the three of us decided to run away, and we did. And of course, all the train stations were guarded very heavily by Germans and by Hungarians. Everybody had to show any, you know, the identification. We didn't have a thing. Okay, we ran away, all three of us.
How old were your brothers?
My older brother, well, he was born in 25. My oldest brother. How old
he
was he?
19.
Wow. 44,
19,
yeah, 18. 18, 19, yeah. And I was 11, mm-hmm. 10 or 11, and my brother was 13 or 14. So anyway, a miracle do happen, because otherwise I would not be here. And for some reason, the moment we were standing in line to be checked, and they just something went on somewhere else, and they turned around, and we just went in.
On the train?
On the train. And then we bought a ticket, and we went on the train. There was one little problem. We didn't have money, Slovak money,
mm-hmm.
from Hungary to Slovakia. So the same thing when we came to the... in order to be able to cross the border, we went back to the same people that my mother knew, the family of the name, that lived in Hungary, on the border of Hungary, border of Czechoslovakia to Hungary. And we knew where they lived. Since we went there, we remembered. And we went to this little village with the train. And we stepped off the train there. It was night, and we waited until we went to the bathroom, or I don't really exactly remember, it might not have been guarded as heavily. We went to these people and told them we are here and please help us. Of course, it was their life on the... And so they said, fine, we cannot do it anymore, because the border is so heavily guarded that they are not willing to do it again for no money in the world. What they did, they took us to the fields where they thought that it might be easier to cross, and it might be not as badly guarded, and people don't use this crossing so much. So they know it, they were peasants, they know the area 100%, and they took us and told us how to go. So the three of us went. And they gave us some kind of recognizing points, which were, of course, absurd, because we didn't know the area. Mm-hmm. The first time in our lives that we went all by ourselves at night on an open field. So anyway, we did make it, and we crossed the field, which it was winter, and it was this weather. The snow came all the way until the knees, it was muddy, but we crossed it and we arrived to the street, to some road that they told us in advance that we will find. We slept in the, how do you call it, the roadside ditch.
A ditch, yeah.
And in the morning when it started to be, well, we slept. You can imagine how we slept. We didn't have a thing, we couldn't take with us anything. No belongings whatsoever, not that we had none, but nothing at all, because it would have been even more suspicious. We arrived, so then we got up, and we had a terrible problem to get from there to the train to go to Bratislava. So we did find out by the descriptions that we are in Slovakia, because they said that we have to arrive into a big... not village, it was a farm. It was a farm, you know, in Europe, the farms, the big farms are built usually by small, how do you call that? Somebody doesn't have a big title, a small title, small...
Government people?
No. Monarchy.
Oh, like a serfs or something.
Yeah, some small. So yeah. It was big, and you could see that they have, and that's how we found out. And then, it was Sunday morning. It it was lucky that there was not many people were coming. The peasants didn't go to the fields. It would have been very suspicious otherwise. So by chance, the carriage that takes those whatever people, the gentlemen to church, came this way, and we asked him for a lift. And he was very amazed. I mean, you know, it's like falling from the sky. Who are you? So he didn't explain too much. He said that we went for a long walk and we missed the road and we didn't know how to get out. We didn't want to go across the border to Hungary, so we just stayed until morning. And so he said, well, I will take you to the train, but it's really not right. And my brother had a fountain pen, which he gave me. That was all the money. Couldn't have, you know, we didn't have enough money for the train. So he paid, we arrived to the train, luckily. The thing was terribly suspicious, and the fact that he didn't go to the gendarme was just luck, plain luck. Anyway, the train was very guarded again. They guarded it not because of people, they guarded it, I think, at this point, more from the enemy. And so they didn't really pay attention to us. We got on the train, it wasn't enough money, and we paid only half a ticket for my brother and me. And I somehow tried to make myself as small as possible, which was pretty difficult. Anyway, we arrived in Bratislava. My parents did not have an idea that we are arriving. Now, when you get out of the train, you have to have a ticket that you paid. It's customary everywhere. I don't know, in the States I haven't used the train yet, so I don't know how it's done here, but that's how it's done in Europe. You have the ticket and you have to show it at the gate too when you get out. Also, you have to show your identification, especially in Bratislava. And I cannot tell you today what happened, but we were not checked. So we had very close friends, Jewish friends, close to the train station. Bratislava is a pretty big city and you cannot walk. And at this point we weren't able to walk. It would have been awfully suspicious after such a night in the ditch to walk across Bratislava when every Jew was picked up.
Did you have a star still on your clothing at this point?
Only my coat.
You didn't take them off, you kept them on your coat.
You try to imagine in this weather to sleep in the ditch.
No, I don't mean taking your coat off, but you didn't try to take the stars off?
Oh, no. There was no star. We did not.
Okay.
Come on.
No, I know. I'm just wondering if you had taken them off.
In Hungary, they didn't have yet the star. This point, they started to have, I think, a band, a yellow or a blue band. Mm-hmm. I don't remember. In Czechoslovakia, you had the yellow star with a blue lining on it. Blue whatever. Mm-hmm. But of course not.
Okay.
But it would have been still, people, you know, it's not like here that you don't know. Even here people know more or less, you can pick them out. So anyway, we went to these friends and of course immediately gave us money to take the tram to home. And this was actually the first time, to my sorrow, the last time that I saw my father cry, that he was so, you know, excited and emotionally moved that all three of us at once arrived. Because they actually were almost convinced that they will never see us again. So then there was my sister that had to come home.
She was still in Budapest.
She was still in Budapest, and they did not, no persuasion made them let her go.
Now, were your parents still in their own home? Or were they?
Well, we had to change homes. Well, it happened when they took our shop.
In 42?
In 40.
40, right.
A German guy, I don't know if they lived in Bratislava before or he just decided because of his duty to be transferred, they came in one day and said that we have to leave the house. And we had to leave. So we went to live in the ghetto. The ghetto in Bratislava was not a closed ghetto, but there was a street where most of the Jewish community lived, poorer, usually. So everybody had to go and live there. All the Jews of Bratislava had to leave their property and everything and live in the ghetto. The ghetto was mostly gypsies and Jews. So it happened sometimes that a gypsy exchanged his place with the Jew, which was, you know, the lowest rank on the totem pole. It was the lowest, you can imagine, the gypsies. In all Europe they are, or they used to be. Meanwhile, we had to change twice already, and this was the last place where we had. There was no bathroom, no toilet. The toilet was outside somewhere, and the whole, you know, the, a whole story, not story, a whole, yeah, one story of people that lived on the same, they all had to use one toilet. It was terrible, no, what shall I say? And we were six of us, we lived in two rooms. And not only this, but not only two rooms, but there were sometimes some people that came across the border, Polish Jews that my father picked up in the shul, that he brought home for a night or for two, just to, you know, not to let them stay outside and they fed and whatever. It was, so it was. And it was nothing special. I don't think that we were outstanding. There many of these religious Jews thought that this is a must. It's, you do it because you are a Jew. And so we arrived home and my sister still was there and it was terrible. And I can tell you that I saw my mother getting gray hair in 6 weeks. And I mean, she had more or less the same color like I do now, which is not the regular, it's already graying, but she got gray in 6 weeks. It was from the sorrow and the pain and the scariness that her child is in Hungary. So finally my sister escaped there, not only Hungary, she escaped her own relatives. But anyway, she arrived one day home the same way as we did, and thank God it was okay. And then that was in March, approximately April, she arrived home. Things were starting to be deplorable in Czechoslovakia. They started to send to the German and Austrian concentration camps all those Jews that were in the labor camps in Czechoslovakia. Sometimes they picked up Jews and they just killed them on the spot. And it was unbelievable. It was just awful. And I'm not speaking anymore because that's obvious that there was absolutely no possibility of shopping. We were, we had only certain hours of the day that one can go out, and it was just terrible. I myself, I imagine, because being a kid and didn't understand really the real danger, and I honestly tell you, I did not have ever any fear at all. And it might have been some mistake of the nature, because I just never was afraid of anything. And I went out and I did shop, and I for all of us, there was no bread to have, only on rations, and that was not enough. So I went to all kinds of little bakeries and I said, well, I'm so hungry, I would like to have just a little slice of bread. And then I collected three or four big slices of bread and then it was hell. Anyway, it doesn't matter, it's not making myself go on. Only the fact that things were really bad at this point. So in September 1944, they knew that this is it, that not much will be left anymore. The Hungarian Jews were completely gone by this time. They deported them all. I have not the exact dates, but I know they were all gone. They were deported, I think, in 4 months, all of them. including that family that my sister was there. So my parents decided to hide each one of us separately. They did have all kinds of friends, non-Jewish friends that they... also my father hid most of his money, or at least a big chunk of money, which was a nice sum, with a gentleman that took over my uncle's shop. And he took it over. I'm saying it in this way because they were more or less friends, and they did it out of goodness in order to be able to return it as is. And this way they more or less had some possibility to take care of it. Now, since my father did trust him, he left money there. The guy, it was an older gentleman, was some professor of something, I don't know what, and he had a son who was in the Nazi party of Czechoslovakia. Now, that was in September, beginning of September. I was sent away with a friend of mine to a family outside of Bratislava in some village, and we lived there at a peasant woman's house. She was a widow and she had a son. We could never eat any more kosher, of course.
This was September?
September, beginning of September. I don't know exactly the dates. Mm-hmm. I never bothered to look it up.
Sure.
I'm saying that it's beginning because the importance of the date is that at the end of September, I think was Yom Kippur, Erev Yom Kippur, mm-hmm. my parents were sent away. They were deported for good. Why I say all this is that the interest, since you ask me and I'm interviewed, you want to know my fate. We were there, the widow was the mother of the people that took me in. They lived in Bratislava, but she lived outside of Bratislava, which was, I don't remember the name of the place either. I cannot remember. It was, I don't know. And we lived there, the two girls, we were from school friends. Actually, she's here in the States. And at a certain day, these people came back from Bratislava and said that I have to leave. Not Edith Gutter, who was my friend, she didn't have. And why did I have to leave? Because the Germans took my parents and there won't be anybody to pay for my stay. It was all done for money, of course. So I took, she took my things. She said, I would suggest you don't take your all your things because it will be very suspicious. So I said, fine, I will leave it here. She says, very well. So I left with a coat and with nothing. And I went to Bratislava, and I went to the place where I thought my sister is hiding. The problem only was that she wasn't there anymore, because these people did the same thing to her a few days ago. And I don't know where she was. She wasn't there. Nobody was home. So there I was. How old was I? 12? I was 12 years old. Not yet 12. I just couldn't imagine what else I can do. There was one more possibility, which was in walking distance, because I didn't have a penny at all. I didn't have one drop of money. There was walking distance, which was outside of Bratislava, and the walking would have been about 6 miles. And I could have done it. I did it before when I didn't have to, but it was a walk. I didn't do it alone then. I could have done it. It would have been awfully suspicious that a young kid is walking in the middle of September. It was cold. It was very cold then. To walk around. I could have done it. That was the last possibility. And the very last was that I just go to the Nazi or wherever, to the police, and say, here I am. But I wasn't yet at this point. I went to look for my sister, and then I went to that gentleman that had the money. Okay, so you go where the money is. And I went in, and my sister was there. It was per chance. And at this point, his son arrived for some reason. And he said, oh, you don't have where to go, I will take care of you.
The Nazi son?
The Nazi man. So it was, since the old gentleman was there, he said, well, how will you take care of them? And he says, since my wife and child are living outside of Bratislava because of the bombardment that went on, and to save them, I will take them there, and they will just hide in my house. Not a house, it was a rented house. Peasant house. Fine, so it was an absurd situation because the whole place was as big as that. And that was for the two of us and for the three of them. No bathroom, no kitchen, no nothing. So anyway, we went and we were happy to have that, and we still, my brother was still at those people at the original place. Thank God. So, I did not have an idea where he is. I didn't even know that he is. That only my sister knew. So we went there, which was, if you want me to write it down, it is Nitrianska Streda.
This is a little village outside of Bratislava.
Pardon?
This is the little village with Nazis.
The Nazis were everywhere. It was a little village, and it's because of the bombardment. In smaller places, they bombarded much less than such a... Bratislava is the capital of Slovakia, and they had a huge amount of industry there. There was oil refineries and everything. It's at the Danube, and there is plenty. It was really a rich place. So they were bombarding it a huge amount of time. So that was when they arrived there, and he had a little hole in the wall doing soap, a chemical, whatever. He was making soap. He had actually a degree in chemistry. He was a chemical engineer, so that was what he was living from. And he took my sister to work with him, just fine. The only problem was that one day when he turned out that there is money, because he said, so what, it turned out that we have money with his father, he said, it turned out that he would be interested in the money. So how do you get the money without being dirty? He had a cousin in the same little place. That was family, that's why he went there, I imagine, who was also in the Nazi party, very active. He wasn't active, he just belonged. But that one was active. He was wearing the black or uniform and whatever. And he told him to pick up my sister. And one day they just picked her up from the work, from his place, which was in a very small city beside the Dnipriatska Streda. It was a city, not a village. So my sister was a very pretty young girl. She was 17, I think. And all those guys, young guys, Guardis, they called them Hlinka Guard. And she was put there, and she was, of course, asked and questioned and whatever, and the last thing she said that there is one thing I insist on. Either you shoot me here on the spot, or I don't leave this house. It was a big house, I mean, it was like a police station. It's where they lived. So they said they were a little, you know, the thing is, the smaller a place is, the more you know the person, and the less you are able to do this to shoot her, a young woman, and there she is singled out. So they said, okay, you are going to be the cleaning woman. And she cleaned the toilets and everything. That's what she did. That's why they kept her, luckily. And while she was doing it, she had a continuous guard. They were guarding her 24 hours. And not to speak about the possibilities of being raped and so on by these dirty, inhuman whatever. But it did nothing happen to her because she was continuously guarded. So while she was cleaning, once after a bang, and while the guard was talking with somebody else, she found out, she tried all those doors and it was open from the inside. So she kept it in mind, and one day at dusk, it wasn't yet night, she was filling up a pail with water, and while the guy was talking and the water was running, she just quietly went out. No running, nothing, no coat, no nothing. She just went. And when she walked, she didn't run, because she knew the moment she runs, it's her end. They would have shot her on the spot. They all were continuously armed. So she was walking, and it was dusk, and there came two of them opposite her on the other side of the street. But since she did not run, and it was dusk, they did not recognize her. And she just went. And she came back to the guy where meanwhile I was sitting there, and I knew what he did. And he ran. What went on behind the scenes in the meantime that she was there, that lasted about 2 weeks that she was there. Okay. And then they told her that tomorrow or in 2 days we have to take you to the concentration camp. We cannot keep you anymore. They just liked her. That's all. You get used to it, Jew or not Jew. So that's why she had to escape. She knew if either one or the other. So she escaped and she came there. Meanwhile, he went and picked up the money from his father in order to pay for the guard to make her let go, to pay for her, ransom money or whatever you call it. And then he said, but they didn't want to do it. He gave the money and they still didn't let her go. So there we were, no money, and my sister was not freed. Now, we knew that the guy is full with grenades and whatever, I don't know, he had a shotgun and he had a little small handgun and everything. It was always there on top of the whatever, cabinet. That was one of, he was not completely right in his head. He wasn't right, but he knew what he was. He would not have done such a thing to save us and then to do all these transactions. Meanwhile, in the same village, there was another Jewish family whom he knew from childhood. They were together at the university, who moved to this little village in order to save themselves. And they moved in there like non-Jews. And they had some papers made up for them as non-Jews. And in the meanwhile, my brother was brought there too. And that all this guy did it. And his name was Fiala. F-I-A-L-A. That was the name of the guy that said...
Okay.
So he brought my brother and they were with these people. And their name is Fuchs. F-U-X.
Is it the other Jewish family?
It's another Jewish family, yeah. And my brother was brought there. He was there. And we all did like if we don't know each other. Everybody knew everything, but... if the peasants in the village... I was moving freely. I was moving like if nothing happened. They let me go out and I did everything, and I just, of course, I helped the house like a little, but they were good to me. They fed me, I was fine. The peasants were awfully nice to us because they were all on the other side of the coin. Most of the village, this village and the neighboring village, they had sons in the army, in the Slovak army, that were deserters. They knew what's going on. It was 44, it was almost 45 by then. Everybody knew what the situation was on the fronts of the Germans. They knew that the Germans are retreating. They knew what's happening in Germany, in Russia, in on the Italian front, and so they knew it. It was obvious that things are starting to be serious. So all the village people were sent up to the partisans. Czechoslovakia is a very wooded country, and hilly and wooded. And it was teeming with Russians and partisans. That's by the way. Now, when Kato, my sister, came back, ran away, she had to come back there. Okay, where else should we go? There was absolutely no other way to do it. He said, my God, you came out, I have to take you to the partisans. That's how his reaction was. We knew that either he is going to shoot us himself, he will take us to the partisans, or something will happen. So he said, okay, we have to go immediately before they come running after you. They will come straight to my house. And he took my brother to, he went, picked up my brother and took the three of us, we went up into the hills, into the mountains, and we were going there for several hours walking. That was in the winter. It must have been December or so. It was winter, the weather was this way, about, maybe not this cold now, but it was snow covered, everything was just winter. And we were walking in front of him, he kept himself behind us. And we knew it was, you know, when you are, you know that the car behind you cannot stop immediately and your hair is bristling. That's how we felt this whole time, several hours. So finally, he couldn't decide to do it himself. He said, and he did like if it's just fine, we are running away. And we couldn't find the partisans because they don't come when you want it. And it was not night. It was evening. It was afternoon. It was actually light. It wasn't even evening. So finally he got tired and he said, you know what, let's go back. Just go back. What happens, happens. He couldn't bring himself to shoot us. So then we knew. It's okay. So he decided. Nobody came to look for us, ever.
None of the people from the police station.
Come on! It was his doing, he arranged it. And since she ran away, they did not that much, you know, the Slovaks are not too bright people. Anyway, I don't think that they suspected that she would have the guts to go back to the same place. That was the reason they didn't even come. So he said that he intercepted them on whatever, and he said he doesn't know, and it was never, nobody believed him. They never ever came. They didn't dare coming into the village, the guardies, because they knew that the whole village, they would just kill them. They were all... The thing is that to know, even here in the States, a small city, everybody knows everybody. Everybody knows where you belong and what your connections are. So people, it's very open. And I think all those people, more or less, if they didn't know cognitively, they knew it just somehow that this is not right. So they just left us alone, they left everybody alone. And that was our luck. Then we had to be transferred to a second village, which is even a smaller. The whole village consisted of one long street. That was the village. And that was better for us because those people were more peaceful and they were really, also they were not Catholic. There is a great difference. The Catholic Hlinka was a
priest, and he was the, you know, it had something to do with their background, historical background of the Slavs, that he went back so far, and that all these nationalistic stories that Catholicism made them be, you know, unite and so on, and the poor Catholic nationalistic, that was their big catch. And that's, these people were evangelic, which is Protestant. It was a completely different setup. They were much more peaceful, not, they didn't want them. Completely opposed to the to the church, or that was why we went there. It was the whole village consisted of them. It was such a small village, there wasn't even a church, and that's something. Also, they were terribly poor. So for a while the guy kept us inside. Then it wasn't possible, we couldn't take it anymore. And my sister, especially, she didn't even go to the bathroom, so she had to use a pail, and I had to. So it was unbelievable. So finally, he bought some broken down house, which was halfway. I mean, it was a ruin, half ruined house, and he set up his laboratory there. So. In a way, part of it was the laboratory, and the other room was the room that he assigned to us, and we hid there, including my brother. It was a hole. I mean, it was so small that there were only two beds and the big oven, which was built in oven. It was mud. Mm-hmm. There was mud on the floor, mud floor, you know, the dried mud floor. Mm-hmm. And that we had enough wood, firewood, but the food was very bad. So we ate mostly beans and what else was there? Beans. We had a little flour, but it was bad. I mean, it was, that started to be very bad because he didn't come. Came occasionally also, you know, how much can you give somebody? I mean, the money that he took was his. He didn't tell us, said he gave it away. So it was bad, and the Germans started to come through the village. And since this was the only, by every peasant house, you can imagine, looks, say, like this house, and to it you have a big yard and a backyard, and it's, all of them are closed up with a gate because of the chicken and the barn and whatever. The thing is all always closed with a gate. So there was our house, which was only the front part was standing, the barn part and all the rest was broken. It was in ruins, actual ruins. So when they came, you know, such a big, I don't know, army, how many came at once, I don't know, with their trucks and with everything, they set up their kitchen in this yard, in our, where we were hiding. We didn't have electricity, of course not, we didn't have, it was at this point so bad, I think that was in February 45, that we didn't have even candles anymore. So when it was dark, finished. Now at this point, the walls of this ruin were so wet, we couldn't heat too much because since it was a ruin at night, we didn't want the smoke go up. We just lied in bed, like, you know, that was all we could do. And then we also, since that we knew the Germans are coming, we saw what's happening, we made the hole, we dug a hole in the room under one of the beds. And when the Germans came, we just sat there in the hole. We put the bed, you know, we put the bed on top of it so to cover up the hole. They did it a few times. The whole, what we actually got from it, that all three of us have rheumatism. That's all we got from it. And there are other things that we all have, all three of us have ulcer, stomach ulcer, we have migraine headaches, we have we are deaf, we have otosclerosis. It must be that it had to be from there. It might have been fungus or who knows what. You never know. But it's interesting that all three of us have more or less the same. And my brother has also a heart condition. He had two heart attacks. My sister has the right side of her brain is affected, the central nervous system is affected, and they don't know what it is. So it doesn't matter. This is only by the way. One day we were sitting and knock on the door, and that very good-looking German officer, he must have been terribly young, came in and said that he didn't know that people live here, he thought that's a barn. But since we are there, he will come and sit with us, and the kitchen will be in the yard. So what can you say? And we did like if we don't speak German, because that would have been obvious, although I don't believe that he would have understood that we are Jews, because it was the Wehrmacht, it was not the Gestapo.
Right.
And they didn't know anything. And they were so young, all of them. They might have been 19, 18, 19. Unbelievable. And he was an officer. So anyway, he was sorry for us and he gave us bread. He gave us candles. You know, it is comical today. Instead of killing us on the spot, he was sorry for us. The condition we were in was unbelievable. So when these people left, we decided that this is no way to live. And we, these Jews were in the next house to us. They rented a house and from another peasant. And they were living there. The lady was highly pregnant. And she delivered a baby there. A boy, of course, it must have been a boy in order not to be able to have it circumcised. And then they said that my brother should come and be with them, and they will say that that's a cousin of them. And at least the two of us were separate, and there were, I think we had a dress, a silk dress, and some, I don't know what, from my mother. And the Mr. Fuchs arranged for us to be taken in by a peasant, and one of the more wealthy peasants. He had four cows, can you imagine? The wealthy peasant. All these people, as I said, their sons were already deserters from the army, so they had to hide. And these people knew. When we came there, we were like family members. There was no other space. They didn't let us sleep in the barn or in the wherever, because they knew. We're just normal human beings. So we slept in their bed, and the old gentleman, peasant, told me, he gave me the catechism, and he told me to, he made me study by heart the prayers, the evangelic prayer. He said, if somebody comes and asks you, what will you say? We told them that we are bombed out, that our parents died in a bombing attack, and that we escaped. Only the two of us, and that was it. The guy knew, because the moment the Russians entered, they said, right, you are Jewish kids. The truth. And we denied it. We said, no, it's not true. We told you the truth. So they didn't care, really. They couldn't care less who we are. They treated us unbelievably good. And so that was, we must have been there a few weeks, 4 or 5 weeks, living with them. And we had the most wonderful insight of peasant life, I must say. It was awfully interesting. They ate from one bowl, the family. They sit, they have a big bowl, and they cook mostly beans and bread. And if you will ever be able to eat real peasant bread that will, I think you will never want to eat anything else. That's the best you can imagine. Unbelievably good. So that's what they eat, they bread and bean, very seldom meat, only on Sundays. And they introduced us to all kinds of things on there. For instance, they don't wash, only for Sundays or for special events. It was terribly interesting, but this is beside the point.
I'm surprised that you could, I mean, when you look back and see it as being terribly interesting when it was, you know, it was also a very traumatic time.
It's interesting, anthropological, you know, from the anthropological yeah. point of view. But, of course, at this point, we were intelligent enough to look around and to see. I also made friends there with the peasant kids, and they taught me all kinds of things that a city, a Jewish city kid had no idea of their, how the things go there, in, I mean, sex-wise. You know, mm-hmm. they opened my eyes. I mean, it was very interesting for a little girl, all these things that went on. I must say that besides the shock that came afterwards, it was not too bad. The problem was, we didn't suffer at all hunger, because all peasants, when they had they kill a pig, usually in the winter, which it goes in every family has a turn, because everybody else comes to help. To kill a pig is a very big job to do. They use up every hair of that pig. I mean, to the last nail is everything used up. So the food was plenty, milk was plenty, bread was plenty. We didn't suffer any after we left that ruin. Also, we got rid of the guy, of the Fiala,
mm-hmm.
because we were not underneath his... He wasn't interested in doing any more trouble, because he was in trouble himself. Everybody saw what is coming. But that's the end, thank God. So at a certain point, the Russians bombardment. The Germans were retreating, always through there. It must have been a highway. I don't understand really how and what. We could look it up on the map if you want. It's not important to this. It's not relevant. The point was that at a certain point, the bombardment and the shooting was so bad, we had to sit inside the room, and we knew that it is so close that that's it. So my sister and me, like two silly, stupid young girls, the relief that finally the danger of life is over, that the Germans are gone, we ran out. In the middle of the big shooting, grenades, whatever you want, everything was coming down. And old peasant ran after us. He really put his life on the line. I mean, it was dangerous. He ran after us, screamed at us like if he's our father, and said, "You are going to stay, it's terribly dangerous." So anyway, they took us in like their children. And then immediately after that attack, either it must have lasted half an hour or half a day, I don't know, you know, the Russians, we saw the Russian jump over the fence, and there he was, and the officers started to come in, and they said, they told the peasants, the whole village, to clear out immediately, because they don't know what the Germans will put up a defense or what. They don't want any human. If possible, the less the better. So everybody out, and they took the peasants there, since it was in the Middle Ages, I'm joking, they had their carts, long carts, that can be prolonged or shortened with leathers, long leathers. They put the hay on top of this, and they put whatever they had, mostly their feather beds, their down blankets and things, because they knew it was March. And you cannot sleep outside without being covered. So they took this, and they took their four cows. That's what their possession was. They couldn't take the house. So that's what is the most important to a peasant. The cow is also a working animal there. not only milk. And we were up there in the mountains for a few days. There was no time to take any food because we were in a hurry. And they just took care of us. They gave us to the milk that they were milking warm, from the cow warm, in order to have something warm. We didn't dare making, no burning wood because the forest, it's their forest, and they, you know, nobody is crazy to make a fire when it can really start igniting a big, it could have brought trouble. So they didn't warm, that's what we got, warm food, and the old peasant slept under, and his sons, three sons, they slept under the carriage, and they put us with my sister and wife and the daughter in the carriage in order to be covered. I mean, I mention it because it is unbelievable. It's really fantastic. But I'm terribly sorry that we never went back. So that was the end of the hiding. After this, the Germans, things started to really collapse completely. I think about a few weeks later, the whole front collapsed, and it was the end of the war in Czechoslovakia, at least. It was more or less the end of the war arrived, I think, May 10 in 45. So we went back in March to Bratislava to find ruins and desolation. People started to come back from concentration camps, which was terrible and awful. And I had a grandmother, she was my second grandmother, how do you call that? She was a, step-grandmother, yeah. Mm-hmm. But the family was family, so her children, which was my father's step-brothers and sisters, started coming back. They all were deported, of course. They all started to come back. My aunt, that was my father's actual sister, came back with her family. She lost a daughter. My grandmother, so my 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 aunts and uncles, which were mostly aunts, one uncle, came back from concentration camps with part of their family, also not coming back and so on. And most of my father's brothers died in concentration camp, which was 1, 2, my father, yeah, that was all. The three of them died. My mother died in concentration camp and my brother didn't come. Being active in the Zionist group, we went back to, it was then very, very active after the war. I think from Israel they sent people that were starting to organize and so on. They start organized, and we were in those organizations, very active, and in 46 May, I was on my way to Israel.
By yourself?
Yeah, but it was with a group,
Your sister and brother stayed, were still
back. My sister and brother stayed back, my brother went, first my sister went, also illegally, and she was kept in, what was the camp in Israel, forgot the name. She was kept in a camp by the British, and then my brother went also illegally, and he was in Kafrisin, in Cyprus, also in that camp where the British kept them. So finally we all three were in Israel. I think that we can stop now.
Well, I just would like to know
I can give you, I just, honestly, this is really, I mean, I thought it is more relevant to the Holocaust.
Well, it's just always important to know what happened.
Do you want
to
know actually what is, where my father is buried and so on? or that is not relevant?
That's whatever you would like to tell. I thought since you were telling about how you arrived in Israel, you might tell me, like,
sure,
how you, if you got together,
no,
with your brother and sister and where you went to school and you must have married there and how you came to this country, just shortly, if you don't mind.
Okay, sure, no. So I was sent to Jerusalem, to Beit Seirot Mizrahi, which is a girls, all girls school, of religious girls school, and I was with two other friends from Czechoslovakia also. They were actually Holocaust survivors. They were both in concentration camp. In fact, there were more, but I'm talking about these two special friends because we were close. So we were in that Beit Seirot Mizrahi. They taught us Hebrew first. Then they put us straight into the regular school. And we had to, that was from the Aliyat Noir, which was actually kept by the joint American money. We were given education and part-time, that was a housekeeping school. So we had regular education, and then we had to work 4 hours in kitchen, in cooking, and they actually taught us with teachers the manners, how to serve, and I mean, like a, how do you call these schools, these very posh schools here, the finishing schools, okay, that's more or less. And many of the teachers, these ladies were from Germany, Jews from Germany that knew what to do, which actually was wonderful. But at a certain point I have had it, and my brother arrived. And he was sent to Mikveh Israel, which is an agricultural school in Israel. And they were more kept like a hachshara, which was preparing them to go to a kibbutz settlement. And I, being very idealistic at this point, I wanted to be part of this too, so I asked for a transfer. But before this, when we arrived at the Haganah, the Irgun Haganah came and asked us if we are, whoever is interested in taking part in the Haganah. And all of us did. All of us girls that came at this point because of the background. We just felt that this is the right thing to do. Meanwhile, the British had problems in Israel. You know what went on. I don't have to go in this detail, but we were actually given a training by the Haganah, weekly training. We were taught using of gun, jiu-jitsu, and kapap, which is the martial arts with sticks. Jiu-jitsu is also martial arts, and we had the training weekly. Sometimes we were taken out for a few days longer in a camp, in a camp situation, actually, in order to be prepared. Then why they did it, because they had they felt that the girls had to defend themselves from Arabs even more than boys for self-defense in case they raped, because that was the biggest problem with the Arabs, that they not only do they cut your throat, they also rape you before that. So then we were actively distributing flyers, which was terribly dangerous, because if you are caught by the British, you were sent to jail, and that was no fun. They meant it. There was absolutely no mercy. All the British gentlemen, like whatever, is all fake, and it was then real taken very badly and seriously. Then I went to Mikveh Israel after the year and a half or so in Jerusalem, which was 47, and there I was active also in the Haganah. All of us there were organized in the Haganah. We were being prepared to go to a settlement, and there my brother was there, so I had a little more family. My sister went to a settlement she arrived, she was left, let go, and she settled close to Kfar Atta, which is near Haifa. And at this point, she already went down to Be'erot Yitzhak, which is a kibbutz, 3 miles from Gaza. And in 47 December, my sister married. The problem only was that the day before she married, the war broke out a little before, and they shut off all the roads to the Negev. So nobody came to the wedding. And it was really very bad. Now, the Arabs, of course, attacked the moment that it was proclaimed a state of independence in 47, I don't know when, 48, beginning of 48, right? It was a little, I don't remember, you know, sometimes spring, but before this, the war broke out already. And the Tel Aviv and Jaffa is so close, and we were close to Jaffa, Mikve Israel, very close, it's walking distance. The Arabs started to fight. They came into little settlements, even there was a little factory, spirits for making alcohol, denatured alcohol, and there, it was only guarded by Haganah members, and they just killed them and dismembered them. That was just one of the things which I, why do I mention it? Because we were involved actually physically. The boys that were our boys in my class had to go and clean up the mess. I mean, it was inhuman. Also, all of us gave blood to the Magen David Adom and things like this. Just to, we had to be on guard, girls too. My room was facing the Arabs, Jaffa, so one evening while studying, they were sniper. They like to do their killing this way from far, so they shot at me. I was a little too low, so it went above my hand and ricocheted down to my friends under the bed. So then they built walls on the windows, and it was bad. Meanwhile, my brother-in-law, the new brother-in-law, got wounded down in the kibbutz. The kibbutz sent all the women and children up to Tel Aviv because it was so dangerous. The Egyptians were actually inside the kibbutz. They were so close, and they still withstood them. There was no water because they bombarded the water tank, which in the Negev, usually that's how they keep their water. You know. And my brother was in I don't know really where he was. He was a soldier somewhere. I didn't know really where he was. So then that was the end of the war came, and I left Mikve Israel with the group, and we went to Shavetzion, which is close to Haifa, and we were part of a... I'm sorry. First we went to Sde Eliyahu, which is in the Emek Israel, because it was a borderline kibbutz. So we were sent as a help, more or less, because of the, in case something happens there, they are attacked. Also, the boys were sent, I cannot remember. Yeah, we were first in Shavetzion, I'm sorry. First we went to Shavetzion, which was close to Haifa, between Haifa and Naharia. And then the army took the boys to training because it was that time came and they had to be soldiers. And then they resettled us, since it was relevant for the borderline places to be on the border. That's when we went there. And from there, I decided I wasn't a soldier. I still wasn't yet old enough. I was not 17 or so. I decided that I don't feel like staying there. I didn't like that. It didn't suit me. And I went to Haifa. In Haifa, I went and I didn't have anybody or anything, because the family that I had left, those people that came meanwhile from Czechoslovakia, they could have given me accommodations, but they didn't. Also, there were all kinds of other things, dirty things, which I don't think it's necessary to mention. It was very difficult for us. The shock that my father received back, well, that they gave us back after the war, was more or less empty of goods. My uncle took over, and he said that since he's only starting and came back from concentration and he doesn't have money, I'm back in Czechoslovakia yet, before I left to Israel. And he will give us money once he starts making money from the store. So we said, fine, okay. I never saw a penny from this money, ever. Because there was a devaluation and there were... That's what I was told. I never really saw anything. He said that he did pay money for the store to the another end, but the devaluation actually... The whole value of the money was gone. There was not a penny. And meanwhile, here we were struggling. We didn't have anything. Whatever we did, money-wise, working or however we could, that's what we had. Or what we received from the kibbutz, shmatez, I mean, real rags. It was really bad. You know, it is very difficult today or in an American environment to even imagine how we had to make do. That one doesn't have money and you don't have anything and you just... That's how it is. Everybody more or less was in the same boat, so you didn't feel that you are poor, that you have to be sorry for yourself. Also, I must say that I really cannot tell where from that energy or the will to survive was kept in me. I don't know, until this day I really... It was terribly difficult. Also the pangs of pain that the parents didn't come back. The month and years of dreaming that the reality is a dream and the dream is a reality, they were real bad. Now in Czechoslovakia, back in Czechoslovakia, immediately after the war, I got typhoid fever, and I lost, as you can see, most of my hair. I was lost. This disease goes with hair loss. I had braids and the thing, so that's what is remained. And I was in a hospital, quarantine hospitalized, because so it wasn't... Meanwhile, also my grandmother got the typhoid fever and she died from it. It was real bad. The outlook of life, that one went to Israel and the new place and new people, the hope and the feeling of being uplifted and the will to survive this British occupancy, actually, I cannot tell you where it came from. It's something that must have really come from the youth, or maybe the way that the country was building, you know, the feeling that you are part of something terribly big and important, the enthusiasm, the idealism that all of us had, that is indescribable, really unbelievable. especially if I think what it came down to today in Israel. Yeah, it is not, it's not funny at all. The high morality, the feeling of closeness and togetherness, that you know, you could feel that you are all in it together. That was an unbelievably good feeling. And I think that the feeling that they, it was a new home, that must have been a very strong, motivation for all of us. And there are people that actually suffered 10 times worse than I did, because I did not suffer in a way, you know, at least this is how I said it. I never had any fear at all. Which I sometimes think is stupid, because one should be aware of the dangers that are out, but it just didn't bother me ever. And then I'm sorry, I forgot, where did I go back now?
You went back to Haifa.
Yeah.
And
to the, yeah, and then also in Mikve Israel it was also very good, because there was a fantastic atmosphere, and people were wonderful, and all of us were the same, in the same boat, all children from the Holocaust, then people from Czechoslovakia arrived, friends of mine, cousin of mine, it was people from the school that I didn't even know that they survived, you know, all these things. And I must tell you a terrible thing which is very relevant, that I had all these years by dreaming, it's not so many years, it just seemed to me that it is a long time, from 45 until 48 was not such a long time. And all during all these years I was continuously dreaming, and the difference in how it was, that the independence from coming from real down death camp to the independence of the country, the change was unbelievable. So I forgot my what I want to say by this. What was I saying about?
Well, you started by, you went back to Haifa and you were back in Israel, and your friends, and you're with people from home. And
that Mikve Israel, I wanted just to mention what a very good atmosphere, and how good we felt, and it was just great for us. I mean, the memory as a child, you know, the good feeling of feeling free and feeling as a human being was undescribable on the one hand. On the other hand, there still were going around stories of people that came back, that everybody gave up hope. That's it, and they are dead. And actually, all at once somebody appeared out of from Russia or from somewhere, that he is still alive. And at night, I must have been in the camp a day or 2 days, maybe one day, and it was evening, and we went to eat in the dining hall. And I heard the girl talking loud and saying something, and I recognized it was my childhood friend from Bratislava. She has a speech, it's not a disorder, she says the R like the Germans, R, like this, like the suppress. So it was obviously that I recognized her. I mean, I screamed in the night, I said, Hetty, is it you? And of course, and it was very interesting. And then we were in the army, and I was in the Nahar, which was again border, kibbutz borderline guarding. I didn't enjoy it. And then I went to Jaffa, and I was in the engineer corps. I worked there as just in an office. So after I finished the army, I went to Jerusalem, because I met a girlfriend that was willing to keep me in her room for money. So we shared the room, and then I started to work. It was very difficult at the time, because there was nothing to have, no jobs available.
money was unavailable from no source. My sister was in a kibbutz. My brother was also in a kind of a kibbutz, so nobody that could support me. I did not want to go to my sister's kibbutz because I felt that she is not really fair to me. She would be, you know, too much supervision. Young girl, just didn't want. And I didn't feel that at this point I want to be in a kibbutz. I just had it. I felt that I did what I could for my country. I didn't get anything back, I mean, in return. All these people that didn't do a thing, they got jobs, excellent jobs. They were trained in the army. They got good jobs in the army. And I somehow always only had the bad end of it. And I was actually bitter. I just felt I have had it. I just want to do it for myself. So then slowly I got a job, part-time job, and then I went to another bank. I got a good job in a bank. Very shortly after I left the army, I met my husband, and we were friends ever since. And I mean, sometimes even today we are friends. And that's it. That's more or less it.
And you've been in this country 14 years?
14 years, yeah.
And did you come right here to Southfield? I mean, is that where you came from, Israel, right to
Michigan? No. We were first in Cleveland, Ohio, and then we came to this beautiful. Yeah.
And you have children?
Yeah, I have two daughters. Or both of them were born in Israel.
I see. And do you go back to Israel often?
Pardon?
Do you visit Israel often? Or?
Not often. I would like to go this year, but I don't know. It's very expensive.
And your sister and brother are still alive in Israel?
Yeah, I have my sister has four children. Her oldest son was in the 73 war. Lost his left leg down in the Sinai. He was an army officer, a tank commander. And he has 4.5 children, all boys. My sister has one daughter who is married to an economist, and she is a teacher. She left the kibbutz, and she has two sons. And she has another daughter who is finishing now being a dentist, medical school, and then dentist. She also left the kibbutz because she wanted to be a doctor. She has only one son, which makes it to 7 grandsons, no granddaughter. And my brother is in Jerusalem. He has one son and a daughter. The son is not right. He's in an institution. The little daughter is a genius. Absolute wonderful little girl.
Do you have any final thoughts you would like to add to the tape before we stop?
I have many final thoughts, but I don't know if this is the way I would like. It is terribly difficult, really, for me. I've tried to make it a round story, so there is something that one can hold on to. Of course, it's a huge amount of holes that I left out that have to be filled in, but I think this is the only thing I am trying to do to catch anybody's attention and telling them that I am a survivor. Yes, there was a Hitler that did kill 6 million Jews, and I try also to hope that we never again. This is all I can say, that I don't believe that if ever such a thing will happen, I don't say it cannot happen, it can happen. I absolutely believe in it. There is always a possibility that it can occur again. I hate not to be part of the Israeli scene today, because I did dream of bringing up my children there. The reason we are here is that there was no more space for us. We were unable to get a job. My husband was unable to get a job, a decent job, in his profession in Israel, which also is a little bit of a, how do you call that, rancor that I have. that I keep. It's rancor, it's not good. But what can you do? So you try to do the best. I do have depressions. I did suffer after my second delivery of a postpartum depression, which nobody can tell if it's from the hormonal change or if it's background. And, you know, it somehow sounds like the Passover song, the Dayeno. It's only if only what I went through the child, Dayeno. So it doesn't matter. I do have bouts of pretty bad depression when I was in the Mikve Israel youth, that I had bouts of actual suicidal feelings, which I never revealed to anybody. Of course, that would have been, you know, the end of the world. You don't do that. I did try to keep myself sane, and since I do have children and a family, it never came to be that bad. But it sometimes can come to very bad feelings, which can be just as normal as anybody that didn't go through it. I don't know. I still do think that I'm... Also, I believe that I did have some brain damage from the shock of my parents not coming back. I am convinced of it. And I mean actual brain damage in the sense that I have problems expressing myself. I find myself not finding the right expressions, which I do have in my vocabulary. I don't believe it's from being able to speak five languages that I would suffer from it. It's just, I'm convinced that it's a blockade, a mental, it's a brain damage, I'm sure about that. It wasn't, you know, I didn't go and check it, but it's an intelligent guess. What do you have to say about it? I try not to project my feelings of being lost or being abandoned on my children. I don't feel that it is fair of any of us to burden them with this. What I do try is to make sure that I say it loud and clear enough that they should not intermarry. And I'm scared, very much scared of what that it might occur to me. And I did send them to Hebrew school. I tried to show them some kind of religious frame. I'm not religious at all, but I do try to show them that the Jewish identity is one of the strongest things I can show. It might have been a reason that I had the strength and the sanity to be what I am.
Enough?
Oh, fine. I just, the part of